peaceful interval, where your streams of abundance flows. Blessed be your name. And blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. When the sun is shining down on me, when the world is all as it should be, blessed be your name. And blessed be your name. On the road it's marked with suffering, though there's pain the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Oh, you give and take away, oh, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Does anybody have something to share?
Your glory, God, is what our nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. All love.
rising up from this old ground. Out of chaos, life is being found in you. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of the dust. You make beautiful things out of us. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of the dust. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us.
The Savior say, thy strength and it is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. As sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and and melt this heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Now before the throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall then repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. His sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Please be seated. Okay, if you're ready to fasten your seat belts, we'll pick up where we were last week. You know, the last few weeks we've done a lot of work in the early chapters of Genesis, and I think we've done some good foundational work, and that work is important for, as I've said over and over, if you're going to understand your whole Bible, you're going to understand the start of Genesis, and almost no one does, and so. I'll point out some scriptures today that people, you could, if you want to go and study commentaries on the scriptures I point out today and come back to me with one that has a good explanation, and I'll be proven wrong, but I don't think you'll find on some of these because they don't understand what happened at the start. They don't understand how we started. So we've been working on this. We've established that the tree of life is in fact Jesus Christ in the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is Satan, as is also the serpent. The serpent is Satan. I've showed you those painstakingly, and I think in the last couple of weeks. Last week, we looked at the fact that the first sin event of mankind had nothing to do with picking fruit from a tree and eating it, which is really, if you stand back and think about it, preposterous. It had everything to do with Satan seducing Eve and taking her virginity. So I've been kind of putting in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, and further into our own words as we worked on this. And a lot of the words I used last week and this week are in your announcements, so you can see where I'm coming from. I want to continue reread some of the paraphrasing. It says, "Now Satan was more deceiving than any of the earth creatures God had made. And Satan asked Eve, 'Did God say there are certain trees in the garden that you can't enjoy?'" And remember, we have shown that God sometimes talks in groups of upright trunk things with leaves in the covering, leaves or hair, as a group called trees. Did God say there are certain trees in the garden that you can't enjoy? And Eve said to Satan, the enchanter, we may enjoy the seed producing parts of the trees of the garden, but your seed, God has said, ye shall not enjoy it, neither shall you have affection toward him, lest you die. And Satan said to Eve, you won't die. God knows that if you enjoy me, then your eyes will be open and you'll be like a God yourself, knowing good and evil. When Eve saw that Satan brought gifts of food, that he was attractive, that he could tell her the hidden things God had kept from her and Adam, she was seduced. And afterward, she had sex with her husband, Adam, also. Verse 7, and the eyes of them were both open. They realized what they'd done. They knew they were naked. And the guilt resulting from their sexual encounters made them aware, I'll tell you, of their reproductive parts. It says, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Very specific. And that's the way, there's so many specifics here in Genesis. It's more and more if we'll just open our eyes. Right there in verse 7, it is very specific if we'll look. We can see specific actions that Adam and Eve took because of their specific sin. We could see that in their shame, they were covering specific parts of their bodies. The parts that were involved in their Satan coerced rebellion against God. Again, I know that what things I'm telling you are vastly different than things that you've probably been taught before. So I want to keep bolstering what I'm teaching. I want to keep backing it up. So let's use some logic. Let's just stop and let's use some logic here. Would it make any sense at all that Satan would seduce Eve? Does it make any sense at all? Well, let's consider, what do we know of him? What do we know of Satan? Well, we can know from reading our Bible that he was a cherubim that served immediately to God's throne. We can know that he led worship in heaven, that he was the most beautiful of God's created creatures. We can know these things. That is until pride got in the way. Isaiah 14:13 says, for thou hast said in thine heart, and this is the fall of Satan. The fall of Satan, pride. Thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. You need to understand that Satan's clear desire is to stand in the place of God. His clear desire is to be king. His clear desire is to be worshipped as only God deserves to be worshipped. So we come to this point in Genesis where his attempt to still the worship of God in heaven has failed. He was cast out. He led a rebellion. He cast out with the 30 angels. So now on earth, in the Garden of Eden, his best shot at being worshipped would be to hijack the human race. He wanted a human race as his own. He had no access to the heavenly host anymore. And what better way for him to secure that worship is to take the human race as his own. What better way than to take this woman who God has created for Adam and take her as his own wife? If he did so, humanity would be done for. We'd be a hopeless lot. And this is exactly where the story was headed until God stepped in his mercy. Big stuff. Big stuff, I'm telling you. Does it make sense? If we read further, does it make any sense what I'm telling you? Genesis 3:9. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where are you? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that you should not eat? And the man said, the woman, that woman who you gave me, she gave me of the tree and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is it that you have done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me and I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because you have done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. And we've been working on this passage last week and this week. We've read it over and over and over again. But I wonder if you've caught something I haven't pointed out about the specifics. That God created the cattle and the beast of the field. That it's so specific, even calls out two groups of animals. Domesticated animals and wild animals. The specifics of the Bible. You know, this word cattle, we hear cattle, we think cows. Cattle in the Old Testament is a term that means herded animals. It could be, most of the time when the Old Testament talked about cattle, it's sheep and goats. So it amazes me as I look further and further into Genesis, the detail that's there, we'll just see it. Verse 14, upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife and hast eaten of the tree which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake, and sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. And the sweat of thy face thou shalt eat bread until thou return to the ground, for out of it thou wast taken. For dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living. So let's look at this section. Let's see what we can discover. Let's unwind this some. Back in verse 9, it said, the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. So capture the scene here in the garden. Adam had sin and he heard the tree of life, otherwise called the word of God, the voice in the garden. Jesus. Catch the content. God is speaking to Adam from heaven. Adam couldn't hide from the Father in heaven. He couldn't hide from him. But he could hide from the tree of life in the garden. That singular entity, that singular personality, Jesus. As you look at it, you see that? Do you see how Adam is speaking to God about the third party that I voiced in the garden? Now to firm up the things that I've been telling you and showing you, if the things that I've put together for you so far are wrong, then the following sections of Scripture just don't make any sense. God asked Adam, who told you that you were naked? And he asks that with making an assumption that you can see in the follow-on question. The follow-on question is, hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that you should not eat? If you really look at it, you can see God's assumption of who told Adam he was naked seems to be the tree of knowledge of good and evil, Satan. Now think about it. We've already established last week who was in the garden. That being Jesus Christ, tree of life, Satan, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, Adam and Eve. We've established this. Now breaking down the possibilities of who told Adam he was naked. Well, Jesus is God and he knows he didn't tell this information. Adam and Eve couldn't have told themselves. Because they didn't know. Genesis 2:25 says, and they were both naked, the man and his wife. They were not ashamed, for they did not know. So by the process of simple elimination, we can see the only one who could have possibly told Adam and Eve that they were naked was Satan. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the serpent. And God knew this. He knew it when he asked the question. Satan is the presumptive answer to God's question, who told you you were naked? But there's even more. There's even more than maybe you've seen before in this question, who told you you were naked? You know, probably you've read that line hundreds of times, and every time you've understood the question to be, who told you that you were unclothed? But is that the discussion at hand here? If you do some word search in the Old Testament, if you look up the word naked in the Old Testament and see how it was used, you'll find that in Leviticus chapters 18 to 20, when God puts prohibitions on sexual interactions, on the sexual activity of man, the term that is used over and over and over for sexual interactions is nakedness. Leviticus 18:6 says, none of you shall approach to any of his near kin to him to uncover their nakedness. I am the Lord. It says Adam and Eve knew that they were naked, meaning that they had become sexually active. They had become sexually aware. And when God asked, who told you you were naked? The question is, who introduced you to this activity? And the man said, the woman who thou gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree. Sin always brings blame, doesn't it? And the indication here is she gave me what she learned from the tree, otherwise known as the serpent, otherwise known as Satan. Significant that Adam doesn't say that Eve gave me a piece of fruit or a nut. Again, it's all about the detail, if you'll see it. Pay attention to the detail. If the tree and the serpent, the tree being the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, if the tree and the serpent are not one and the same, if they're not Satan, then it doesn't make any sense when confronted by God that Adam doesn't mention the serpent. If this is truly a snake in the garden, isn't that a glaring omission? And I did eat, it said in verse 12, or as we looked at last week, enjoy, I did partake. And the Lord God said unto the woman, what is it that thou hast done? The woman said, the serpent. Her choice of words are a part of her defense. The serpent. Adam used the word tree in his excuse, basically saying the upright one. In contrast, as part of her excuse to God, Eve chose this word serpent, which in the Hebrew language means the attractive one, the glimmering one. The attractive one beguiled me, and I did eat. Beguiled, the Hebrew word that we get beguiled from is nashaw, N-A-W-S-H-A-W, nashaw, a word that only means one thing. Most of Hebrew words have several varieties of meaning. This one's very narrow, one thing, seduced. Putting it into our own words as we're learning, and God said unto the woman, what is it thou hast done? The woman said, the attractive one seduced me. It's just that clear. Now, if I'm wrong in the conclusions that I'm making, if I'm wrong in the things I'm sharing with you, if this is actually about a snake and an apple, as many of you are wishing it was about, as I wish it was about, because it would be so much easier to teach and we'd be about four books further down the road. If this is actually about an apple and a snake, then what comes next? The punishment that God's about to hand out in response to this original sin event are completely random if it's about an apple and a snake. And if his punishments are completely random, then God must be illogical. And God I serve is not illogical. Let me say that again. If the snake convinced Eve to eat a piece of fruit that God didn't want her to eat, and the resulting punishments are what we're about to read of, then God is at best illogical and maybe a psychopath. that that's not God. But if you look at it in the proper context of what we've determined to have taken place, I think you will agree that God hands out punishments that are not only relevant, but fitting to the crime, specific to the sins committed. I think you'll agree that as we look at the punishments handed out, that God is not only supremely logical, he's also just and he's fair, that justice is served. 14, the Lord God said to his servant, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Now, this is one of those difficult passages that I cannot find a single commentary that has it anywhere close to what I think is right. And I might not have it perfect, but here's how I see it. What does this mean? You're cursed above the cattle of the field. When God created the world, before there was sin here in the Garden of Eden, at the original point of creation, there was no death. And that didn't only include mankind, that included the animal kingdom. There was no death. Thus, the animals that he created were going to live forever. And because of what Satan did, what he convinced Adam and Eve to do, sin came in and death came into the creation. And that curse of sin would affect everything. It would affect the animals, that they would die. But God instructs Satan that he's cursed above the animals. That his curse is greater. Animals were going to know termination. They're going to know death. Satan is cursed above that. He is going to know something more. He's going to know eternal death. He's cursed above all the cattle. Upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life. The twin of this verse, that you won't find commentaries that do it any justice. It's a hard commentary. If you find somebody that understands this stuff better than I do, point it out, because I want to know it. I want to read it. And it's not a prideful thing. It's I want to support that says I'm not off my rocker. But maybe I am. If you read the commentaries on this, you can find countless opinions, most of which will tell you that there was indeed a snake in the garden, and at one point in time at the beginning, the snake stood upright. He had arms and legs, and because of this curse, his arms and legs were removed, and now he slithers on the ground. I think they've lost the context. Verse 14, it says, and the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly thou shalt go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be unto thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. The context of the curse on the serpent, the context is God setting prohibitions to prevent Satan from taking Eve as his wife. To understand verse 14, you have to understand what Satan's original desire was. That his desire to be worshipped caused him to want to hijack the human race. If you don't understand that, you can't understand properly what verse 14 is saying. Most don't understand that Satan's desire was to grow the human race as his own corrupted race. And as punishment to that, God says, because you've done this, you will know never-ending death. On your belly you shall go, dust you shall eat, meaning your appetite. You know what he wanted to do? He wanted to take the human race for his own. He wanted to raise them up as his own so they would worship him. Here's a stark turn at this cursing of God. He says, dust you shall eat, on your belly you shall go. Meaning that your appetite is going to be for destroying man, not nurturing him to worship you. For destroying man, not for seducing them. dust you shall eat, God said. Your desire was to raise up a polluted human race to worship you. Your reward, your diet will be the dead bodies of men. Dust you shall eat. Dust the dust. We're made of the dust. To dust we shall return, and that's Satan's reward. Until God says, I cast you into the lake of fire for never-ending death. Again, is there biblical support of this? First, are we dust? Does it make sense? Are we dust? You don't have to go far to look at the answer. Go backwards to Genesis 2:7. Where it says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. He became a living soul. Then look forward just a little bit to 3:19, where it says, for dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. We're dust. Does Satan now seek to and desire to devour us? 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking who he may devour. Verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, meaning she will no longer desire you, and between thy seed and her seed. Now, this is a pretty complex prophecy here. God here cements the enmity between the woman and Satan in the very next verse. Verse 16, thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. God is declaring to Satan, you had universal DNA, and I'm altering your biology and hers. You won't be able to impregnate women ever again, even if you desired to. And not only that, there's going to be a perpetual revulsion that women will have to you. There's going to be a perpetual war between your offspring and her offspring. Your seed and her seed. Catch that. It's a big deal. What's God acknowledging there? Your seed, Satan. What's he acknowledging? Well, I agree. He's acknowledging that there'll be offspring of Satan. The Hebrew word zera, Z-E-H-R-A, is what's translated seed for us here. Both for seed of Satan and seed of Eve, the same word. This word's used throughout the Old Testament, and it's always in the context of the descendants of a person. Your seed, your descendants. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Boy, it's a great prophecy here. A great prophecy arising from the fall of man that God's got to fix in the works already. Saying that the Redeemer will come from Adam's line. He will save humanity from what you've done, Satan. It shall bruise thy head, thou shalt bruise his heel. This morning as I was showering, it's a weird place to get something from God, but I got something from God. Don't picture that in your mind. But I was excited about it. God showed me another section of scripture that is so poorly explained all the time. You've all read of the birth of Jacob before. It's in Genesis chapter 25, verses 21 through 26. And when Jacob and Esau, there were twins in their mother's womb. By this time, God's working on this pure line that's going to deliver Jesus Christ that I'll continue to show you. And it says they wrestled in their mother's womb. A type of what's happening here. And it says that Jacob grabbed the heel of Esau. And theologians will tell you Jacob is a foreshadowing. He's a type of Christ. That he helps us to understand Jesus. And And at this point, at that point in time, the, you know, strategy shift, and this pure line of the Hebrew people are being shepherded to deliver Jesus as our Redeemer. And Satan's strategy at that time has changed. What's he want to do? He wants to crush that line. And the one who represents Jesus restrains the heel of the crushing. And I've never seen that before. It's like, thank you, Jesus, for showing me that. And then I dried off and said, hallelujah. Verse 60, unto the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception, and sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. So says, he says to Eve, I'll greatly multiply your conception. You know, the human reproductive cycle, if you look at mammals, this is unique from the rest of God's creation. More specifically, the cycles of fertility are different. And there were biological changes. This first sin event was so strong in the garden, there were biological changes taking place. And I can only imagine, and I can only suggest what the original plan was. When Adam and Eve were put in the garden, there was no plan for death. There's a plan that they would have dominion, that they would populate the world and with creatures, with humans who are going to live forever. When would that have happened? How frequently would they have children? 1,000 years apart? 10,000 years apart? I don't know. But you see, everything changed with sin. That a race, if you will, had begun. And God multiplies the conception of woman, that more frequently she can bear children. That he's put her into submission, that she's going to rely on her husband. And I'll tell you, until recent modern times, when birth control was so easily had, historically, women in the childbearing age were perpetually pregnant and dependent on their husbands. And you can follow that all the way back to the garden. The first sin resulted in genetic modification. I want you to see that because of Eve's role in the first sin, God specifically altered the parts of woman that were involved with Satan, involved with this first rebellion. It says, in sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. That childbirth became more painful than God had intended it to be. Thy desire shall be to the husband, he shall rule over thee. You know, as we read the opening of Genesis, and Eve was first created from the side of Adam, that she was to be an equal, a meet partner, an equal partner. And now, because of this disobedience, the human female is put slightly lower into a submissive role, a role of need for the husband. You see, Eve didn't need Adam. She had no dependency. And so Satan's seduction was that much easier. Well, now she's going to need the man, and she's going to be repulsed by Satan. God, in effect, said, because you were so easily seduced by Satan, from here forward, you're going to depend on your husband. And you'll desire him above all others. Your desire will be for him. That's very specific. If in the context of what I'm telling you took place, your desire will be for your husband, not for the attractive one. You know, I'm so happy for that, because Donna come out on the short end of the stick there. Even the ugly ones have a chance. But I want you to see how specific the punishments are. After changing the physical attributes of the first two adulterers, Satan and Eve, you know, I already told you Satan's not going to have this universal DNA, however that worked. See, Eve's female parts are changing. God did that to prevent this specific sin from continuing, to stop Satan from trying to hijack the human race as his own. It's very specific as you continue reading that, when the punishments come to Adam, who did not participate in this first adultery, there's no physical change to him. His sin was in allowing it to happen. His sin was perhaps in watching it happen. It says in verse 17, and to Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife and hast eaten or enjoyed of the tree or the ways of Satan, of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. At this point, we can only speculate. Why cursed is the ground? I have my speculation that I can't back them up in any way, so I won't share them with you. Verse 17, in sorrow shalt thou eat all the days of thy life, thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee. In other words, because you were disobedient, I'd set you in this garden attendant, which was a pleasurable activity. You're going to be set out of the garden, and you're going to work. You're going to struggle. You're going to get what your disobedience brings you. Thorns and thistles shall the ground bring forth to thee. Adam is going to have to work now to feed himself and to feed the woman who is newly dependent and more dependent on him. Verse 19, the sweat of thy face thou shalt eat bread till thou return to the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. So God gave notice that the man was going to be expelled from the garden. His diet changed. What we just read, his diet changed. He was eating the fruit of the trees, and now he's going to eat the herb of the field. At that first sin event, God's word was true, that death would come. He shall surely die. At that moment, they died spiritually. Our spirit is the part of us that allows us to be in relationship and communion with God. And those who don't know Jesus, those who haven't been saved, those who haven't been born again, are spiritually, my dead's not the right word. They have no spirit. They are missing that part. And when you're born again, God gives you this spiritual part that was intended for us in the garden. That because of this first sin, the death sentence was placed on mankind and all the creation. This was a strong event. This extends to the entire universe. The entire universe is wearing down. Where God made it to last forever. So genetic changes took place in the garden as God passed these judgments. Satan would no longer be able to impregnate human women, even if he desired to. Human women, their reproductive cycle and emotional wirings changed. And every living thing began to decay and end. You know, it's a couple hard weeks to take you through this because you start to understand how ugly and disgusting the first sin event in the garden was. And then right behind it, you begin to see how specific and how fair, how appropriate were the judgments, the punishments that God hands out, that there's no randomness to it. Again, if you believe this is about an apple and a snake and a tree, and you look at the punishment that God hands out, it is illogical. If you understand what happened, God is very specific. He's very specific. As you begin this, you start to see what fools we've been made. We've been made fools to understand a fairy tale. We've been fools to be made to understand an idyllic scene in the garden. Again, I have a photograph in my mind that you might have the same one of a tree and Eve standing there with a fig leaf and a snake coiled around a tree and her plucking an apple. It's very idyllic. Now, think of the irony of that. You have an idyllic vision in your head of the first sin. That's kind of a conundrum, don't you think? You have an idyllic vision of the first sin in your head. Now, you know, my intention's not for you to go out today and grab every Christian you know and get in arguments with them. Like, you don't know what happened in the garden, I do. You know, most pastors, if you run to another pastor, most pastors will tell you, well, I'm teaching you is heresy. It's not the normally accepted teaching. Most of them are ignorant. They're blind to it. Let me remind you again, as I did last week, of the words of the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2. It says, for I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. What's that mean? Virginity is a condition relating only to the sexual matters of a woman, to a female. And when Christ called the church to be his bride, he expects us to act as a bride, as an espoused bride, as an engaged bride, having allegiance only to him and to no other. And do you? Is your allegiance to Christ? Or is your allegiance to your bank account? Or is your allegiance to your home or your car or something else? Are you acting as a member of the church as a chaste virgin? Reading on verse 3, but I fear lest by any means as a serpent beguiled Eve or seduced Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted as the simplicity that is in Christ. I'm telling you, the minds of the church have been corrupted. The church doesn't even know this. Is Paul's concerns legit? I think they are. In other words, Paul's saying if you turn away from the simplicity of reading God's words and looking at what it says on the paper in black and white, if you trust instead, if you're lazy in that, if you trust instead what other people would teach you, never reading for yourself, never looking, never checking what they say, you're going to be beguiled as Eve was. You're going to be seduced to something else. This writing of Paul can only have one meaning, that the church not be seduced and lose its virginity, lose its single-mindedness to Jesus. And I ask you, what's drawing you, and Jim, I'm closing if you're ready. What's drawing you, what's tugging at you, what draws you away from Christ? And should sober us as a church, and we look at the things we do, and as a church, what's our desire? We need to guard that. You know, we could get all heady and high-minded, and we could think, boy, you know, Don and I dropped off those shoeboxes the other night, and I looked at a sanctuary. It was really, really nice. And we could get lost in something like that. We could start some big building fundraising event and shift all our fundraising from sending it to missions to building a building and thinking to ourselves, boy, if we just had a better building, by golly, we instead of being a church of 40 or 50, we could be a church of 300 or 400. Well, if they're coming in to see the building, we're missing it. And if I ever start talking to you about a building fund, someone smack me. We need just to be about Jesus. We need to be as a chaste virgin for Jesus, single-mindedly pursuing what he would have us to do. Let's stand and let's worship as we close, Jim. Pray as we close today. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for revealing truth. And Father, as we looked at the lesson this morning and we saw genetic modification happening in the garden, we know that you're the creator and you have power over even the molecules. And Father, as we close, I want to lift up Anna Jean and Kathy Tucker to you, both women who are battling with cancer, and that you would manifest genetic modification in them, that the poison that is poured into bodies by the doctors would be as health to their bodies, that the side effects would be minimal, that healing would come quickly. In the name of Jesus, we proclaim victory over cancer. We're stepping outside the fences that him is in to natural man, we're stepping out in your power. To you be all the honor and the glory and the magnificence. May we forever testify the name of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you.